Hey guys, welcome to Collider movie talk for movie fans. I'm your host, Ashley Mova, and this is the daily show where we give you all the latest news from the world of movies, put some insight into what it all means. Leading off the show today is John Campea.
Well, greetings and salutations, everybody. Welcome to 2017. We hope you had a great, fun, relaxing, safe New Year's, and we're ready to get things rolling.
Also, we are host of Jedi Council, Kristian Harloff.
What's going on, guys? Happy New Year. Happy to be back with these bunch of hooligans.
Also here, Jeremy Jahns.
I'm here between two schmoes. I'm starting 2017 out with a schmo-witch, and this is the way to do it.
Also here, Mark Ellis.
It's a chubby schmo-witch, Jeremy, because I put on 10 pounds over the holidays and plan on doing another 10 in Omaha this weekend.
Is that true?
Yeah.
Nice. Oh, congratulations.
Yeah. I am juicy.
Fat Ellis.
I don't ever want to hear statements about Mark Ellis and chubby and juicy. All at the same time. Please, no.
True. And we're back.
True. I missed New Year's Eve this year. True story. I was in Canada. I watched the UFC fights till about 1:30 in the morning, East Coast time. I had to leave the house at 5:30 in the morning to go to the airport, and I couldn't sleep, so I didn't sleep all night. I can't sleep on planes. We got home around 1 o'clock in the afternoon, ordered some Chinese food, ate some food, going to take a nap at 4 o'clock, tell my wife, hey, wake me up in an hour. I'm going to fall asleep at 4 o'clock. She goes, okay, wake up at 12:45.
Oh, no.
And so, like, I missed New Year's
Canadians
altogether.
Do not celebrate New Year's.
That's really weird. The time zones are completely different.
No, yeah, so there's no surprise. It's like things that we have a different New Year's. Our New Year's is actually in May. That's when the calendar switches over for us. Look, 2016 had some great, fantastic moments, but it also had some stuff that was heartbreaking as well, and that leads us into our first story. Ashley, what's up?
It was a tragic holiday season for fans of Carrie Fisher and her mother, Debbie Reynolds. On December 27th, Carrie Fisher passed away after suffering a major heart attack on a flight from London to Los Angeles. One day later, her mother, Debbie Reynolds, who rose to stardom in Singin' in the Rain and quickly became a staple among Hollywood, passed away as a result of a stroke. We here at Collider Video offer our deepest condolences to Carrie Fisher and Debbie Reynolds' family, friends, and fans.
We all heard the news when she had, I think it was a heart attack she had on the plane. And then we heard stable condition. We all started to hope for the best. Modern medicine, I mean, she made it through the heart attack. They got her into the hospital. I took my mom and dad, one of my new family traditions. My mom introduced me to Star Wars. So every year now I get to go home and take my mom to go see Star Wars, which is just awesome to me. Took my mom and my dad to go see Star Wars, came out of the theater, looked at the phone, and she had passed away. And I had just a minor spoiler here for those of you who've not seen it, or maybe a significant spoiler for Rogue One if you have, but I don't care at this point. The last thing we see in Rogue One is Princess Leia saying hope. And it was awful. I mean, it was absolutely awful to hear. I'll never forget where I was when I had heard that Carrie Fisher had passed away. And, you know, what she has meant, not only to Star Wars fandom, but I think film as a whole. I put up a video the day she died about my reaction to her passing away. One of the things I point out is we cannot underestimate the influence that she and what she brought to Princess Leia had in film. She gave us a heroine, because I mentioned in that video that even today, a lot of studios don't know how to make a strong female character without making them masculine. It's almost as if there's this belief out there that to be strong means to be masculine, to be weak means to be feminine. But Princess Leia and what Carrie Fisher brought to that character, that her and George Lucas worked out with this character, was that we had a character, this female character, who was distinctly feminine, but the biggest badass on the screen at the same time. And what she has set a role model, I think, for what strong female characters can be moving forward, that yes, you can be strong and you can be feminine at the same time. And what she has meant to us, how many hours, it's scary to think, collectively, at this table, how many hours of our life we have spent with Carrie Fisher on the screen playing Princess Leia, or any of the other projects she was involved in. I mean, she was a big social advocate as well. She's a big advocate for mental illness. She had done so many great things in her life. And it was just really heartbreaking and heart-wrenching to hear. Anyway, Kristian, where were you when you heard about this and your reaction?
Well, I mean, initially I was home when I heard the thing as far as when she had her heart attack on the plane. And then when I heard she wasn't really breathing for 10 minutes before they finally got her to the hospital, I started to kind of prepare for it, to be honest with you, because She was a woman, though. I'll tell you, though. She wouldn't apologize for it. She lived life the way she wanted to live life, and she did it. She did it hard at some points, and then she did it in a way that when we got to see her at Star Wars Celebration, it's just she embodied life. I mean, she really did. She didn't care what you thought about her. And she did her thing, from whether it's her writing or being on stage, or obviously as Princess Leia, but Harry Met Sally, you know, Blues Brothers, The Burbs, you know, there's so many different movies and things. It was her personality and the way that she just came at you when you were watching. You, John, you know, you mentioned as far as what she did in Star Wars, and we're talking about 1977, when we see Daisy Ridley in a Star Wars movie in the first female-led Star Wars film, really, as the protagonists are like, wow, 1977. Imagine that she was one of the main characters, the big three. When you say the big three, you're talking about Mark Hamill, Harrison Ford, and Carrie Fisher. And what she did there, what she was able to do, the strength that she showed, it wasn't that traditional kind of damsel in distress. This was someone who talked back to Han Solo, would grab a blaster in the middle of it and start shooting at stormtroopers. This was a different type of princess, and it was Carrie Fisher that made us go, oh yeah. She paved the way for the I think whether it's Linda Hamilton in Terminator,
right, yeah,
or even Sigourney Weaver as Ripley. I mean, that Carrie Fisher was one of the she's iconic for a reason, you know. And she poked fun at herself, whether or not it's having those buns or wearing the gold bikini. She like I said, she never pulled punches, and you knew who she was. The tragic thing to me is also is that then her mom, a day later, you know, it's like that was the one. I mean, obviously Carrie Fisher hit me hard, but then Debbie Reynolds, because just being a parent, knowing what she must have been going through there. And then, you know, the fact that there's some kind of weird comforting thing that she now that they're together, you know, that to me was able to say, okay, I'm at peace with it there. But it's just such a hard thing for the two of them to be taken from us. Carrie Fisher, young, to be gone this young. So it's hard, man.
Jeremy?
Yeah, interesting enough, I watched The Burbs on Christmas with my brother, and we also watched the despecialized Star Wars movies. And it is true, when you were talking about, she's like this OG badass, she was the top three. It was Sarah Connor, Ellen Ripley, and Princess Leia, and it's the scene where they're down the hallway, and she's like, someone has to save our skins, bam, bam, into the garbage chute, flyboy, and she just goes right in there. And I was like, "That she got it done, you know?
Yep.
And so I love that. And this is 1977. This is decades before it was, you know, it was just the natural course of things. Like, no, I mean, I think she would do that. When Luke comes in, she's like, "Aren't you a little short for a stormtrooper?" It's like, that guy could have come there to kill her, but she's still talking trash. I went to the comic book store. My favorite comic book store in Washington is called Olympic Cards and Comics. If you live in Washington, totally go there. But we were talking about Carrie Fisher passing away, but Debbie Reynolds had not yet. And I was talking about the thing I hate most. I mean, there's the Star Wars nostalgia on me also, but the thing I hated most was the fact that a daughter went when her mom was still alive. I hated that. I just don't like seeing kids go before the parents. It just it's an unnatural way of things. And and then a day later, her mom goes, and the two are completely linked. But it really does show how people are, you know. Like, I mean, people are attached and connected, and when something happens to one, it completely affects the other. And it's a powerful thing. That, I mean, as we're talking about it, it is in a negative light, because I mean, it's a sad and tragic thing. But it is just a fascinating thing. It's a powerful thing to see how what happens to one person so completely affects another. You being a parent, you know, you completely understand that. But it's a big part of life that I have nothing but fond memories of, and Shield, they'll both be missed. They really will.
Mark?
It was a gut punch, man. I mean, I was home losing at pool to my sister, and when we heard the news, and it was just, we just had to have a good cry over it. I mean, that's the only way to cope with something like this, because as much as she meant to me as Princess Leia, and she meant a lot to both me and my sister and everybody else in my family, and I'm sure a lot of you guys, it's that Carrie Fisher herself, when you watch her, whether it's in a movie or it's in her writing or it's her doing a one-woman show, she was so funny. She was so funny.
She's so funny.
She had the best trait of a sense of humor, which is just complete, raw, utter honesty. She would never be less than truthful about anything she was going through, anything she had gone through. And I got to check out a little bit of The Princess Diaries, which is her most recent book, where it's her today, but it's also her when she was 19 filming Star Wars. And to see how somebody would release that and say, no, this is what I went through, this is what I am going through, it's incredible. And it's just a small encapsulation of everything that she meant. And to see the outpouring of emotion from everybody all over the world, both with her and Debbie Reynolds, I thought was fitting. I'm glad that so many people around the world at least got to honor them. And I think Max von Sydow said it best when you're talking about Carrie Fisher, when he said, you know, to you she's a general, to me she's royalty. And I think that's how we all feel.
You know, somebody, a bunch of people sent me the link the day that she passed away. It was a fantastic link. If you haven't seen it, look it up. I think Mark Riley shared on his as well. But it was from a couple years ago when AFI was honoring George Lucas and Carrie Fisher came out to speak. I don't know if you guys have seen this one yet. If you want to know how funny Carrie Fisher was, it is one of the funniest things I had seen in all of 2016. And she ends it with this great line where she looks at George Lucas from the stage. She goes, did I sleep with you to get that role? I sure hope so, because if I didn't, who was that guy? And I just about fell out of my chair. She was incredibly gifted and incredibly talented, and she will be missed. I'm sure we'll talk more about it when Jedi Council comes rolling around later this week. But for that, let's move on to the next topic today.
All right. In an extensive interview with Ben Affleck by The Guardian, the Oscar winner spoke about his career and his latest gangster-era drama, Live by Night, when the conversation naturally turned to his next project, the standalone Batman movie, which he's slated to direct. At least, that's if all goes according to plan. Talking about the project, Affleck said, that's the idea, but it's not a set thing, and there's no script. If it doesn't come together in a way I think is really great, I'm not going to do it. Jeremy, based on Affleck's comments, do you believe there's a chance he won't direct the Batman standalone?
Yeah. I mean, with a comment like that, I have to assume there's a chance he's not going to direct the thing. Didn't we talk some weeks ago about how this thing was supposed to wrap production in fall or something like that? It was some big thing where it's like, all right, it's going to happen. It's going to get made. This is it. Legit. And now he's like, well, you know, I mean, if it doesn't come together, I guess I'm not going to do it. I don't know if it's because of Kristian's review of Live by Night. I don't know. But I haven't seen Live by Night. But it's like a gun-shy twang where everyone was super confident about this Batman movie, and now there's like a couple people, including the director, who's kind of pulling back like, well, you know, I mean, if it doesn't come together soon, I'm going to have to walk. The thing that was making me look forward to this Batman movie was Ben Affleck's take on it. And if that's going away, this is going to concern the heck out of me for sure.
Kristian.
I don't understand what the hell's happening over there. Dude, this guy a month ago was talking about, oh, the script looks great.
Yeah,
can't wait. And then they're announcing Joe Manganiello is going to be. And it's like there's so much hype behind it. I think this is Ben Affleck. Behind the scenes, things aren't working. And he's going, look, man, I want to do it this way, my way. And it's what we talked about not too long ago with the DC stuff. Is it too many cooks in the kitchen and what's happening? Ben Affleck's probably, this again, speculation, but he's just in an interview, no, script's not ready and I'm not going to do it if it doesn't work right. He's that type of guy that's going to say that thing. That's basically what he said. They asked him because this must have been such a shock because it must have been so close to a meeting because you know he's having meetings about all the time. The script's not where he wants it, obviously. And he's like, no, I'm not going to do it if it's not. I probably won't even direct this thing at this point. So he looks like sounds to me he's fed up. He's not getting a point. What he wanted to do isn't coming across in these meetings. And the other thing, like Jeremy joked about it, but with Live by Night, for me, out of the four movies that he's done, this is my least favorite. This also might be an opinion. It was Warner Brothers, so they're just like, ooh, I don't know, maybe we should try to do this instead. And it's like that fickle thing. He's done three great movies for you, one okay. Let him do his thing for this movie, and it doesn't seem like that's happening.
I didn't mean to interject or anything, but that is a fascinating thing. By him not doing it, I just thought directing it hadn't even crossed my mind that he wouldn't play the Batman by his statement of, I'm not going to do it. If he doesn't play the Batman...
Well, I'm sure he's contracted to do it.
Yeah, but you wonder if he would do that, because if he's not directing... If he doesn't have enough confidence to direct the movie, it's going to look horrible. If he's like, I don't want to direct this piece of crap, I'll stand there in the bat suit, and I'll have Michael Bay direct me, but I'm not going to be investing my time in directing it. If he doesn't direct it, he ain't playing Batman either. I don't think either one of those scenarios is going to happen. I think that this is a little bit of maybe publicly admonishing Warner Brothers for not getting their stuff together sooner with the script and all that. I think this is just a way to be in the press and roll up the newspaper and hit him in the nose a little bit. I wouldn't panic, but it doesn't bode well when he was so excited in public a month ago, and now it's like, let's just pump the brakes.
All right. Giant red panic button.
Right. I'm panicking.
I'm panicking. I'm completely panicking. Because how bad does something have to get where it actually gets to the point where a guy like Ben Affleck is coming out and press saying, hey, I might not even do this.
Right.
Like, seriously, how bad does it really have to be behind? Now, look, let me say this right up front here. Everything I'm about to say is completely speculation. We don't know. We only have a finite amount of information here. There might be other information that will totally contradict what I'm thinking, maybe what we're all thinking here right now. But this is the information we have, so I'm going to speculate based on this information. Let's not forget Ben Affleck is the one writing the script. Him and Jahns are supposed to be doing this script together. Not this Jahns.
Oh, okay. Not me.
That
no.
would be a disaster.
A talented Jahns. A different guy.
Him and Jahns are supposed to be doing the script together. So what's Ben Affleck coming out in the press and saying, the script's not where I want it to be right now? Well, you're the script writer. Two things come to my mind. Either number one, because like you were pointing out, Kristian, it wasn't long ago that Ben was saying, I'm really happy with the way the script's coming along. We're not there yet, but it's really happy with the way it's coming along. Two, I don't know. Maybe I don't do this thing. What happened? I have two possibilities in my head. Again, remember, this is all speculation. Number one, exactly what you're saying, Kristian. Warner Brothers is sticking their nose in. I have, like, this sounds to me like Ben Affleck is making progress. Him and Jahns are making progress on this script. He likes where it's going. And now Warner Brothers is coming in and poo-pooing on his ideas. And they're interfering with Ben Affleck, which is fine normally. But you just said Ben Affleck's your exec producer of all this stuff. You just said Jahns is your high guru of all your films. Well, if these are your top people, then you let your top people do their thing. So are they really not the top people? Are you just saying you promoted Jahns to this level as a good PR stunt when really he's got no power whatsoever? The other possibility here, and this is the one that scares me even more. What if Affleck and Jahns are not on the same page?
Well, that's probably the most. That's probably the one that is.
But
the most
that's the one that scares me the most.
Yeah.
I would almost rather find out that it's Jahns and Affleck say we got a script that we like, and they just got to pound it into the Warner Brothers executive said to let us do it, than the option of Jahns and Affleck are not on the same page.
Right.
And if they're not, I'm sorry. I know everybody thinks Jahns is this big god in the movie universe. He's done crap. He's done nothing in the movie world. All right. He's done nothing. If this is a situation where it's Affleck versus Jahns. You throw out Jahns and you go with what Affleck wants to do. Look, there could be five other options here that are much more innocent. It could be that maybe Affleck's just frustrated with himself. Maybe he's just mad at himself because he's a bit of a perfectionist, that he can't get his script to where he wants it to be. And maybe his comments are really more directed at him than they are directed at anybody else. I'm just saying on the surface, if it's Warner Brothers interfering with Affleck and Jahns, not good news. If it's Affleck and Jahns not being able to get on the same page together, not good news. I'm telling you right now, I think there is a very real possibility that this doesn't happen. I think there's a possibility. Now, if I had to put money on it, I'd say it happens. But I'd say there's a solid 30% chance that we are not going to see Ben Affleck direct a Batman movie.
I don't think you're crazy, but I think that the other thing, the question for the table here, too, as you guys are talking about, and I'm thinking about it, what do you think this means for Justice League? And the reason I say that is because Ben Affleck just shot Justice League. If Justice League is incredible and it's awesome, wouldn't you think that they would kind of play off of everything that happened in Justice League, where he's like, no, I'm going to ride the high here, and then we can write, or maybe this did happen, and then they can't get on the same page. Either one of those scenarios, but does it mean anything for Justice League? Like, how do you think?
That's what it smells like to me, is that you're having problems getting the standalone Batman movie to play with the rest of the universe that you have built. But what you have to remember is that a lot like Iron Man and Captain America are the Marvel movies that drive the action that's going to happen in Avengers and Infinity War for the most part. Batman should be that vehicle. It should be Batman and Wonder Woman that are the two standalone films that help drive the action for Justice League and set it up, because Batman is the crown jewel of the DC universe. So you should let them do whatever they want to do in the standalone world. It smells to me like they're just trying to get that to jive with whatever Justice League Part 2 might be.
Yeah, I just think that a Live by Night would have crushed
Mm-hmm. There'd be no problem.
I think Warner Brothers is going, do what you gotta do.
right. Yeah, I do think that if Justice League is great, and I mean, he is a huge element in Justice League, they're going to have to roll with him and be like, hey, look, you know, you're Batman. We can't just recast you. We can't just like have some, because like you said, if he's not directing the thing, I don't think he's going to be in the thing. But maybe, as we've seen, John has said a few things that have changed the movie-going world. Maybe they're like, Affleck's like, look, man, Campea says you guys are being reactionary, and we can't do that. And they're like, look, we're going to react right now, and then that's where the conflict's going. I think, you know what? Do what you need to do, Affleck. Do what you need to do.
That's what Warner Brothers needs to know, is that John Campea hit an Aquafina bottle and called it the red
button. Yeah, it's an orange button that is not the red button.
But remember, let's put the explanation point on this again. A lot of this is all speculation.
Yeah.
We're theorizing here about possible scenarios. Maybe everything's fine. Who knows? And look, it's not just a big question mark of what if Justice League is great. I think the Justice League trailer was awesome. I think there's a good chance it's great. What if Wonder Woman crushes and Justice League crushes?
Right. Mm-hmm.
How does that change the landscape, right? So look, I it's very interesting times ahead for the DC Cinematic Universe.
Yeah.
We're going to keep our eye on this really closely. All right, what's next?
It's Monday, which means it's time for the weekend box office report brought to you by AMC Theaters. Rogue One took the number one spot for a third straight weekend at the box office, pulling in an estimated $50 million over 3 days and a projected $64 million for the four-day holiday. The first Star Wars story has now made $425 million at the domestic box office, making it the second highest-grossing domestic release of 2016 behind Finding Dory. Singin took the number two spot for a second weekend in a row, pulling in $41.4 million and $53.7 over the four-day. At number three was Passengers, which took in $16.1 million over the three-day weekend and $20.7 million over the four-day. Moana took the number four spot with $10.15 million over 3 days and $13.5 million over the four-day weekend for a domestic total of $212 million. And in the number five spot was Denzel Washington's Fences. After going wide last weekend, the Oscar hopeful took in $10.1 million over the three-day weekend and an estimated $13 million over 4 days. Mark, do you think Rogue One has a shot at becoming the highest-grossing domestic release over Finding Dory?
I certainly do, Ashley, and I would root for it to do as such. What really shocks me about this weekend is that Moana and Sing both increased their take from last week. And I get that it was Christmas, but I thought a lot of people see movies on Christmas. So this really bodes well for the animation vibe right now. I am shocked at how well Sing is doing. Sing is doing so well, it has a chance to compete with Moana and actually make more money total than Moana if it can catch it. I mean, this is pretty encouraging stuff if you like animation, and certainly if you're a Star Wars fan, you got to be encouraged by what Rogue One is returning so far, and why him is going to make its budget back, which is good, because I thought the movie was funnier than I thought it was going to be.
I also thought why him was funnier than I thought it was going to be. I enjoyed that one a lot. Rogue One, though, you know how many movies would kill to say on their third weekend they're making like $50 million just domestically alone?
Right.
This thing, by the time the show is over, this movie's going to cross $800 million worldwide. It's going to break the billion-dollar club, no problem, all that kind of stuff. This is right around where we expected Rogue One to be, so that's really cool. Seeing Sing do well, I'll be honest, I didn't like Sing. I didn't like Sing that much, but it is kind of nice seeing it doing so well. Passengers, Moana, Why Him, Fences, La La Land is still hanging around there. Lots of really cool things going on. But yeah, Rogue One, $50 million on its third weekend is kind of crazy.
Yeah, I mean, another thing, that impresses me, like Mark was saying, I mean, Moana is just not giving up. It's been on the top five since its release. What was that, 2 months ago?
Yeah, Thanksgiving.
It's a long time.
6 weeks.
Yeah, I mean, in a world where Rogue One is still number one, not surprised there. 50 million, I am surprised. I didn't see Sing or Fences. I didn't catch those before I split out of town to spend 10 days up in Washington with the family for the holidays. Passengers... Yeah, I guess that's still on there. Not for long. Not for long. I'm just saying. It's not going to be
Fences,
for long.
Fences, though. Fences, that's a great haul, too, for Fences. $10 million.
Yeah, in the top five, for sure. Absolutely.
With very little marketing.
Right.
I was going with Fences and Moana, both in the four and five spot. That's big stuff.
Mm-hmm.
Because like you said, Mark, Moana's been out since Thanksgiving.
Yeah.
And it's a great movie. It's probably one of the best animated movies of the year, if not the best. And then you've got Fences, which honestly, look, I've the play to me, I loved the play, and Denzel in the play was great. I didn't love the film itself. I loved the performances. I thought that it was a harder transfer to film for me. However, I think that it's great that there was $13 million or $10.1 million for the opening weekend that people said, I want to see this. I want to watch this. And they did, and they went out and they supported it because they are performances that you should check out, especially with the Oscars rolling right around the corner. Mm. You're going to see a lot of noms there. But, yeah, Rogue One, look, when you look at a movie like you were mentioning, John, to have such a little dip, and I think it goes back to, myself being one of them, the Star Wars hardcores. I mean, it really is. That's repeat business. That's what it is. I mean, I get tweets all the time about, I've seen it a third, a fourth, a fifth time. It's that type of movie that is going to always benefit from that. I mean, even The Phantom Menace did it. You know, Attack of the Clones, not as much, but still.
Phantom Menace, we were like, did that really just happen?
But people kept going back and seeing it, and that's the thing with Star Wars, that if you give, especially now with Rogue One, and we're in the new age of Star Wars here, this brand, people are going to keep going back. Episode 8 is going to see the same thing happen, for sure. So it doesn't shock me. I'm obviously glad that it's doing as well as it is. I agree with you. It's going to hit $1 billion. Singin, I also agree with you. I didn't love it, but it's because you have, because the people that did see Moana went to check out the new animated film, and it doesn't surprise me.
All right, guys, we reached our part of the show now for buy or sell. Here's how this works. In front of her ass, she's got a few other items in the world of movie news. She's going to run them down. Then those of us at the table are simply going to say whether we buy it or sell it. So, Ashley, what do we got?
Last week, a report from The Wrap claimed Ryan Reynolds had filmed a cameo role as Deadpool in Logan that was allegedly shot by Deadpool 2 director David Leitch. Soon after, Hugh Jackman, director James Mangold, and Deadpool himself, Ryan Reynolds, took to Twitter to debunk the claim, with Mangold even going so far as to call out The Wrap with the hashtag fake news. Later, however, THR's film reporter Boris Kitt tweeted that his sources said Deadpool is definitely not in the movie, but not to rule out something else involving Deadpool and Wolvie in the future. The Wrap has since updated the report with Mangold's responses. Kristian, based on the report, do you buy or sell Ryan Reynolds making an appearance in Logan?
I'm gonna go ahead in Logan. Yeah, that's a big sell. It's not gonna happen. And Mangold, whoo! I mean, was that Mangold tweeting or was that Wolverine berserker style?
Yeah.
I mean, he was adamant, letting you go, no. No! He's like Steve Carell in The Office. No! No!
God, no!
No! No! This was someone that said, you stop that. You stop tweeting that. You cut that out because this is not true. I mean, I don't think that this is one of those things to where it's J.J. Abrams going, no, Khan's not in the movie. That's not this. This is because you can't do what Mangold did and then have him be in the movie.
No.
You can't, because it's one thing, just like, oh, no, you know, not in the movie, don't hear from him again. But this is him going after not only the source, but also going after people who were supporting, just fans that were supporting it, going, watch. At the end, you're going to apologize to me. He was pissed. Go read that thread. And then you have people, Ryan Reynolds coming out and all these people coming out. Not going to happen. Do I ever think that they're going to be in a movie together? I do. I think that Ryan Reynolds set it up in the first one. I do think that, now, whether or not that's Hugh Jackman having a small cameo, or they put the new Wolverine in there eventually, if they're going to replace Hugh Jackman, Wolverine has to be a part of the X-Men going into the future. Now, this particular story in Logan, I think it's the end of the Wolverine that we know, and I don't think that we need to see Deadpool in this one.
Look, first, okay, sell. Had Mangold, Ryan Reynolds, and Hugh Jackman all showed up wearing tuxedos and sent out a joint tweet saying, Deadpool is cameoing in Logan, I would still sell it. It's not going to happen. That would be one of the most monumentally stupid things Hollywood would ever have done in its history. Right. Have you seen the Logan trailer? Have you seen it? Can you see Deadpool fitting in that at all?
Preach.
There's no possible way. This is one of the most monumentally moronic things I have ever heard said, and I hang around with Kristian Harloff, so I hear some dumb things.
It's true.
Actually, he's way smarter than me, so whatever. But it's absolutely incredible that anybody would have ever thought this in the first place. Reverse it. We've said on this panel, I could totally see a Hugh Jackman doing a cameo in a Deadpool movie. You can make that work. But if anybody has ever seen that Logan trailer, there is no way in hell that a Deadpool cameo would fit at all. It would be so ridiculously stupid. Sell.
I think Fat Ellis has better odds of being in Logan than Deadpool does. Like, I would have thought that anyway, just from watching the trailer and seeing what a different vibe Logan appears to be from what we got with Deadpool. So I already would have sold it. And then seeing this, you guys are right. They've now, even if they had shot a Deadpool cameo in Logan. After this Twitter rant this weekend and seeing Ryan Reynolds and Mangold both and Hugh Jackman come out and say it's not in it, they would have cut that scene. If they were like, oh, let's try to wedge him into post-credits after this, there's no way they would let that on the street with Deadpool. There's a small, just because I don't trust anybody in Hollywood, where, and we've seen it so many times with guys like J.J. Abrams, who will say one thing and then we get something else. There's just the smallest chance that they are just doing this as window dressing. I just don't believe that to be true. This is a hard sell for me.
What do you think?
Yeah, I'm going to emulate, sell, because I usually forget to say buy or sell on these things. Sell for sure. but it does, you do think about, like, are they doing J.J. Abrams? And they're right. Just been like, nah, he's not in it when he's going to be. Or is it like Anthony Michael Hall when he was rumored to be Riddler in The Dark Knight? And he was like, guys, listen. That's not what it is. You guys need to manage your expectations. Yeah. And then it comes out and people are like, oh, I guess he was telling the truth, you right. know? But I completely agree with you, tonally speaking. Having Deadpool come in to the Logan movie per what the tone of the trailer is, it's kind of like having Barney come in at the end singing I Love You, You Love Me in the end of Passion of the Christ. It's like, that doesn't really, that's not, it's
tonally,
I
not
guess
really.
The message is, but yeah. what? You know, yeah. so it just doesn't work at all.
That wouldn't even work in a post-credits scene.
the biblical cinematic universe. I like where we're going, guys. We're going to talk about this afterwards, but so.
All right, what's next?
On Christmas Day, 20th Century Fox unveiled the first Red Band trailer for director Ridley Scott's Alien Covenant. Covenant finds Michael Fassbender reprising his role as the android David, who is now the sole inhabitant of an uncharted paradise, which is visited by the crew of the colony ship Covenant. The film stars Katherine Waterson, Billy Crudup, and Danny McBride, and opens in theaters on May 19, 2017. Mark Byer saw the first trailer for Alien Covenant.
Oh, this is a huge buy for me. I just watched this thing. I just got to see it this morning. It is awesome. There's a lot of mistakes that scientists are still making in outer space. They're still having sex. When I told you guys what's going to happen if you have relations in outer space, aliens are going to invade your body. I thought we covered this with Prometheus. Apparently we didn't. Sorry about that. But the ending of this trailer so hooked me, because we got to see the mouth, and it looks like another little tinier mouth that's dripping with goo is going to be coming out of that. And I loved it. I love this trailer. It's a little, there's bad decisions that humans are making in this trailer that you're going to want to yell at the screen. But because we get what we wanted to get with Prometheus, and that is the xenomorph, I love watching this thing. It's a big buy.
Not a big surprise that, look, I have not been looking forward to this movie because I did not like Prometheus at all. I didn't like it at all. But damn, if this wasn't a great trailer. This is a great trailer. Huge buy for me. And, you know, we suspected they would have learned their lesson. Because remember Prometheus, they were trying to play very coy about the connection to Alien. They almost hid it. They didn't want people to really... Nah, not in this marketing campaign. They're like, hey, guys, waving a big banner. This is an Alien movie. And it was great. It was tense. It was violent. It was visceral. It was all the things we want in an Alien movie. I loved it. Color me surprised. I thought it looked great for me. It's a buy.
Yeah, this is buy squared right here. I do agree with Ellis. If you're going to have relations in space, you got to play Dance the Night Away. Otherwise, everyone's going to die.
Mission to Mars.
Yeah, everyone. Good man. But yeah, this is the trailer that's the binder between the two universes, because Prometheus was Prometheus. And if you look at it as its own sci-fi movie, it's enjoyable. It's more enjoyable than if you look at it as part of the Alien saga. This is the movie that's like, no, it's all part of the Alien world. Let me show you how. This is an Alien trailer. There's an alien busting out of a dude's back. You got the tail coming. Yeah, I mean, people are dying. This looks like an Alien movie with Ridley Scott taking back his franchise. I think it's fantastic.
Yeah, it's a big buy for me. Like, if you were going to use Fassbender singing crazy, this was the time to do it. Not an Assassin's Creed.
Crazy!
Like, okay, that makes sense. The movie looks incredible. It really does. It looks like everything we love from the Alien franchise, and you guys mentioning Ridley Scott, and going back to where... People, look, it's divided on Prometheus. It really is. Mm-hmm. You and I have had many conversations
on
the prequel.
Like, when it came out, you and
many
I.
Many times.
Conversations is nice. I call them like very, very civil arguments.
They were. But they were good. But I don't think we're going to have any civil arguments here. I think we're going to be in agreement that this is going back to what the franchise is all about. And I think that Ridley Scott looked at it and goes, okay, I did that. I experimented with Prometheus that particular way. And now I'm going to get back to the roots. And you see it. You see everything. And this is what you want. Like, I like the movies very much, the Alien movies, Aliens. I'm not like a hardcore like Mark Riley or Schnapp, everything too, but I want to see this movie. I want to be there. And it's a follow-up from Martian, man. This is a movie that just, to me, knocked me off my socks. I want to see this particular movie, what he's going to do. So, yeah.
And the look of the movie is gorgeous. Like, say what you were about Prometheus. Yeah. It looked beautiful.
Well, yeah. All of his movies. I mean, that's what he does.
With the Martian, too.
The cinematography is going to be out of control.
Yeah, and the trailer itself looked great. All right, what's next?
Now we look ahead to the year in movies for 2017 with a discussion about everyone's top five most anticipated movies they're looking forward to seeing in this year. John, let's start with you.
All right, yeah, here we are, first episode of the new year. We'd probably be a little bit remiss to not talk about our most anticipated. No, we had this idea to talk about most anticipated films, and then I quickly realized it was a bad idea. Because there are so many good-looking movies coming out this year that making a five list seemed ridiculously stupid, because I'm going to not be mentioning a lot of movies that I am dying to see. For instance, Logan is not on my list. And yet it is absolutely a movie I am dying to see.
Is it because you found out Deadpool's not in it? Knocked it out of your top five?
Dunkirk is not on my list, but I cannot wait to see Dunkirk. So anyway, here we go. Look, first of all, a quick honorable mention. I'm going to cheat a little bit. One honorable mention.
All right, we get one honorable mention?
One honorable mention. All right, I'll go one honorable mention. All right. War of the Planet of the Apes is going to be an honorable mention for me. This is like 1A, 1B, 1C. It's crazy. So War of the Planet of the Apes gets in my honorable mention. I got John Wick. These are no particular order. John Wick 2, I'm losing my mind to see. Beauty and the Beast. Whether or not it makes $200 million in opening weekend.
It will.
Mark Ellis. Yeah. Beauty and the Beast is one I cannot wait for. Obviously, Guardians of the Galaxy 2. The first one was so great. Wonder Woman is one I am just dying to see. With maybe it's more curiosity than anything else. I cannot wait to see that. And obviously, the only one I'm going to rank here is number one is going to be Star Wars Episode 8. So that's what I'm looking for. But like, how many movies did I not mention that are going to be amazing this year? Anyway. What about you, Jahns?
Yeah, I did a top 10 anticipated video last night, or this morning I just put it up. And that alone, I'm like, oh, there are like 25 I'm looking forward to. So you feel like you are just completely hamstringing yourself, if not not doing the movies justice that you're looking forward to. I have Logan on mine, and these are not in any particular order. I think it's in order of release. So I got Logan on mine, if I have to narrow it down to five. Alien Covenant, we just talked about, but I got to see Ridley Scott bring Alien to the Prometheus world. Spider-Man Homecoming. Spider-Man was my boy in high school. My superhero right there. I love Spider-Man, and they're doing him complete justice as to how I fell in love with Spider-Man. War for the Planet of the Apes is on mine. I'm actually bummed out that John Wick is not, but again, top 10, folks, top 10. And the no-duh scenario is Star Wars Episode 8. My video, I'm like, every year is going to be a Star Wars movie, and every year I'm going to look forward to it because it's the legacy that is literally in my bone marrow. So Star Wars Episode 8 for sure. And I love the fact that we don't have a trailer for it. And what was it? Did Adam Driver?
You
he was like,
might not get
yeah,
one.
Yeah, he's like, it's true. Yeah. We're totally going to get one. But I think that is an interesting thought of just going into Episode 8, nothing. You know, I think that would be the coolest thing ever. That will never happen.
I want to apologize to all my primate friends out there. Look, I'm 98% just like you guys, except I can do this. But I couldn't get Kong Skull Island or War for the Planet of the Apes in my top five.
Crazy
They're
people.
Just on the cusp, I promise you. At number five is Jeremy Johnson's hero, Spider-Man Homecoming. It edged out Guardians of the Galaxy for me just because I'm so curious, and that trailer really wowed me, and I like the inclusion of Tony Stark and how they're going to marry the brands with Sony Spider-Man and the MCU at large. At number four is going to be Wonder Woman. I mean, this is the standalone movie that DC desperately needs. I'm going to walk into that with less trepidation than I will any other DC movie because the trailer really knocked my socks off. I think Gal Gadot and Chris Pine are going to be tremendous in that film. What Patty Jenkins is doing behind the camera looks like the right play so far. So that's definitely my top five. At number three, I'm going to have Thor Ragnarok.
Yeah.
Thor Ragnarok is my most anticipated from the Marvel series of movies, simply because you get a Thor, you get a Hulk. They work so well together. There's going to be a lot of intergalactic implications. There's going to be a lot of fun in that movie and a lot of great action. From what we saw at Comic-Con, if that's any indication as to how the movie's going to play out, it should definitely be on your list too. Number two, it's making me nervous just saying it, but Justice League. Justice League is my number two most anticipated movie of 2017, just because if you put me in a movie theater and you say you got that playing versus virtually any other movie, I need to see what happens when Batman and Wonder Woman start recruiting people like Aquaman and Cyborg and The Flash. I just need to see the movie. It might not be the best movie of 2017, but I need to see it. And at number one, it's going to come as no surprise to any of you guys that I love Gerard Butler, and everything that Geostorm is showing us definitely deserves to be at the top of my list. It's episode 8.
Geostorm.
Yeah, I'll go with an honorable mention here, because like I said, we put up our 10, but like, mm-hmm. so we're going to hit to the number, so if I was going to put a number 6, that's Guardians. I am really super excited for Guardians. That's in my honorable mentions then for this particular list. Number 5 is Dunkirk. Man, I'm a Nolan guy. I want to see what his World War II is going to look like. I want to, I like the we haven't seen the switch from him, so I'm very, very curious. Take that. Some people say, that's not an extra that's looking up on the side and going around the side. Well, that guy ruined the first trailer. Let's hope he has a better role if he's not an extra. And then we get into number 4 is Spider-Man. I agree with Jeremy. What Tom Holland did in Civil War, thank you so much for revitalizing. That's the Spider-Man I wanted to see in Civil War. What's he going to do in Homecoming? I love what we got to see at Comic-Con. They showed that John Hughes feel. We got that in the trailer that they released recently, so that's one for me. I'm also on board with Mark with number 3 for Justice League. I want to see how they're going to do it. Wonder Woman and Gal Gadot's Wonder Woman is going to do a lot for that franchise, but it's Justice League that's going to hold it all together. If that movie, they got to revitalize the whole damn franchise if it doesn't work. So I'm very excited to see how they're going to tie it all together. 2, human work. War for the Planet of the Apes is my number 2. This has been an amazing 2 films. Give me this trilogy. Give me it tomorrow. I can't wait to see it. Apes on tanks. Apes on tanks. And then obviously is episode 8.
So, I mean, look, if War for the Planet of the Apes, let's say it's on par with the last Planet of the Apes movie. Does this Planet of the Apes trilogy get into the conversation of the greatest trilogy of all
yes.
time?
It's in the conversation,
absolutely.
For sure, yeah.
If it delivers in the way that it's supposed to, I mean, the ending of Dawn of the Planet of the Apes with him, the setup, he's like, he's basically Caesar going, get the hell out of here, it's not going to be good. And we see that in the trailer, that it doesn't look good. And I'll tell you that it also really depends on Woody Harrelson. If Woody Harrelson is as menacing inside of that movie as he is in that trailer and doesn't come off as cartoonish, we're looking at something really special here, and I do think Cobra's coming back.
Really?
Yeah.
Wow.
Well, hey, listen, guys, we do this show live, and what we like to do, it's the first show of the year, is at the end of the show, we are going to take some of your live Twitter questions. Just make sure you're following us on Twitter, @ColliderVideo. Start firing in those questions now, and Wendy will pick a few out to ask at the end of the show. I also want to let you know that this is not the only thing on Collider Video's channel today. Just yesterday, we put up our newest edition of Crash Course, Understanding Marvel Licensing. Why aren't X-Men and Fantastic Four in Marvel films? Go and check that out. That is there now. Also, a little bit later today, the newest episode of TV Talk, the first episode of the year. And keep following Collider Video all day for breaking news as well. All right, guys, with that out of the way, let's get to our mailbag. Listen, if you've got a topic or a question you'd like us to address on the show, just email us anytime at collidervideo@gmail.com. Ashley, what do we got?
Schmoes Collide writes, hello, Collider. I hope your day is going well. A main topic that has been brought up a lot this year is that the new Ghostbusters film should have been a sequel instead of a reboot. Considering how it failed to launch a new franchise compared to Jurassic World and Force Awakens, that introduced brand new characters yet still set them in the same universe as their previous films, do you think studios will do less reboots and instead find ways to do sequels? Ocean's 8 seems to be going this route. This not only makes it less controversial, but creates more positive feelings towards the movie. Would love to hear your thoughts and bring on the filthy.
You know, it's always dangerous to say, should a trend and an overall philosophy be set in one direction based off of one movie? And a lot of people point, look, to this day, I'll somewhat defend the 2016 Ghostbusters and the fact that I thought it was okay. I mean, I thought it had some decent laughs in it, and I thought it was okay. I stand by that. However, they also made a bunch of tragic, horrible mistakes, but I still believe it's better than if they had tried to do a sequel. I think a sequel would have been a horrible, horrible mess. I remember the first idea when it came out, it's like, oh, you're going to have like Aykroyd, and because Bill Murray always said he wasn't going to be involved in it no matter what. So the idea a couple years ago was Aykroyd is going to be there, and then you're going to get like Seth Rogen and guys like that, and they're passing it off to the next. And I never thought that sounded like a good idea at all. It all depends on the property itself. Every situation is going to be unique. That has to be evaluated on its own thing. So I don't think the answer is reboot, and I don't think the answer is sequelize. I think you just got to look at the property in general and decide what's best for that particular property. I don't know, Kristian, what do you think?
I think it's kind of a mixture of both, to be honest with you. I actually lean more towards sequels because I don't necessarily want to see, like you were mentioning, with Seth Rogen and then having Bill Murray and Aykroyd kind of passing off, but I would have liked to see it continued into the same universe. I think that Oceans is actually a much better way to do it that way because I don't think you need to have George Clooney and you don't need to have Matt Damon front and center, but you let the ladies kind of run it and then you have them kind of showing this is still part of that thing that you fell in love with, and now we're passing the torch here. I think they could have done the same thing with Ghostbusters, and whether or not it was with the ladies or whether it was not with two ladies, two guys, who knows? But I do think that when it comes to things that people are really in love with, and what the viewer was talking about here is less controversial, because I think that it allows us to still. We invested all that time in those original storylines. Like, I would have liked to seen those female Ghostbusters kind of take us everything that those guys had built. I would have liked that if Ray was actually Leslie Jones, if he was her uncle. You know, it was Ray. Winston. But if it was Winston, that would have been great to me. So, anyway, I particularly would more like sequels than reboots or remakes.
Jeremy?
Yeah, it's all situational. Situational circumstance. Sometimes it calls for one. Sometimes it calls for the other. If we're going on Ghostbusters, I lean with Kristian on the fact that I would have liked to have seen these people, against the advisement of everybody, pick up what the Ghostbusters did because it's what needed to happen. And then, I mean, there's no way of getting around the fact that, I mean, the Statue of Liberty would then be in the middle of the city because that happened to Ghostbusters too. Funny thing is, J.J. Abrams did it perfectly with Star Trek, where it was a reboot, but it was also a sequel, but it used time, so it did both. So the one that did it best is no clear answer, because it's both. But situationally, it all depends on what movie and franchise you're talking about.
I think it's very high risk, high reward if you're going to reboot something, because we're talking about beloved properties here from the 80s and the 90s, and I think Jurassic Park, it's such a beloved first movie that there's no way to reboot that. You maybe if you waited 10 or 15 years, you could have tried to reboot it, but I think they played it right with Jurassic World, and usually that's a safe way to go, is you're not just jettisoning everything that we grew up loving, you're just adding on to the lore. So I think that's a safer play. I still like Ghostbusters, and I like that they took the shot. Whether they made it or not is a different conversation that takes a long time to get through, but it just on the merits of they had a shot, they took it. I think it was the right approach. Maybe they didn't hit it as well as they certainly didn't hit as well as they wanted to, but I think with Ghostbusters that was the right play. I don't think it's the right play with a lot of other beloved properties, like Back to the Future should never be rebooted. You know, Beetlejuice should not be rebooted. Tango and Cash should not be rebooted. You want to add on to these, that's a different conversation, but reboots is by far the more riskier proposition.
All right, what's next?
Richard writes, "Hi guys and girls of Collider, I think you guys are all awesome, and a happy new year to you all. My question is about the upcoming Masters of the Universe movie. Who would you guys like to see play He-Man and Skeletor? I would love to hear your thoughts because casting is important and can make or break this movie. Thank you for reading my question."
Kristian, you've got some connection to this property, some fond memories.
Yeah, I mean, listen, this movie, I want to be proven wrong, it's with McG. I want McG to apologize and say, you know what, dude, you were the right guy for this movie. I just think if there was ever a wrong choice for someone directing a movie, it's this. And I also think it's going to come into the casting, too. You and I talked about this before, so I'm essentially stealing Jeremy's idea. So I'm saying it right now. Well. He had mentioned Chris Hemsworth, and we'll talk about it. So Jeremy, we'll talk about Chris Hemsworth.
Kristian.
I'm telling you first. But the reason why it's going to be hard for Hemsworth to do it is because he's so tied into Thor.
Oh, yeah.
And it's going to be so hard for them to say. It's the type of look is Hemsworth. I mean, it is. It's perfect. But I'm just skeptical about saying he's the guy because it's so hard to kind of say he's Thor. It's just not going to happen. As far as Skeletor goes, I mean, Frank Langella, can we bring him back? He was the best part of that stupid movie when it came out. I wouldn't mind seeing Andy Serkis play Skeletor. I think Andy Serkis would be a great Skeletor because they'd probably do the same thing with him. And if somebody could do this, but they'd probably wind up having him play Beastman. So let's get away from that. Let's have
he's Cringer.
Yeah, he could be in Skeletor.
Many faces.
Yeah, but I think Andy Serkis should absolutely have a role in some capacity. If they were smart, they'd go out and get him. And I don't know how they're going to approach He-Man and Adam. Are they going to do something where Adam is they're going to do kind of CGI for him, performance capture to beef him up? Or, I mean, I don't know what they're going to do.
Jeremy.
Yeah, I'm when we were talking about Chris Hemsworth earlier, Kristian and John, you seem the same boat. We're like, well, that won't happen. I don't live in that world. I don't eat from that world. I live in a world where I have my little box of nerdism, and I can cast anybody for anything. And if I could do that, I would do Chris Hemsworth. I agree that Andy Serkis should definitely, now I'm stealing your idea, because Skeletor is going to be CGI no matter what. You might as well get the king of motion capture to do it. But if you have to go for someone who already looks like Skeletor, Willem Dafoe. Why not?
Mark.
That's not a bad play. Now, I'm going to treat this like fantasy football rules where you guys already took who I would. Chris Hemsworth would have been the number one round pick, right? We all want Chris Hemsworth. If I can't have Hemsworth, because you need to do it, like you can't just be somebody in shape. Chris Pratt got in great shape to play Star-Lord. He's not close to looking like He-Man.
His name is He-Man.
He is so incredibly jacked that it's you can't just have an actor get a gym membership for 6 months and then they can play He-Man. So I'd like to see Chris Hemsworth. If I can't do that and I have to buff somebody up, Nicholas Holt, the guy who plays Beast in the X-Men movies, I think he's got the right look, but he needs to put on about 100 pounds of muscle. As for Skeletor, that's a better choice. I like the Willem Dafoe. I'm going to take your Willem Dafoe and I'm going to raise you, Nicholas Cage is Skeletor.
I'm not laughing.
Dropping the mic.
Come on.
I'm not laughing.
He would be great. What? He's still a great actor. He's crazy.
We're going to get to Eternia.
See?
Get out of here.
That's the worst.
We have to find the sorceress.
I'm not. It all works.
All right, guys. I said we save a little bit of time at the end of the show to take your live Twitter questions, and we're going to do that right now. Once again, make sure you're following us on Twitter, @ColliderVideo. So, Wendy, what do we have?
First one comes from The Lone Wolf, who writes, is The Rock slash Cavill picture on social media an indication that Black Adam will appear in Justice League or Man of Steel 2?
I'll be honest, I didn't see the picture.
I didn't see the picture either.
I follow The Rock on Instagram and did not see the picture.
Yeah. Okay, well, let's put it this way, though. They announced, I was at CinemaCon. I was in the room in Las Vegas when they came out and announced officially The Rock is Black Adam. That was 3 years ago. That was 3 years ago. We still don't have a Shazam movie officially on the books locked.
Yeah.
I mean, so putting him in at some point, I'd be for it. I would be for it. I don't know if I believe that that's what they've done yet, but it's an interesting proposition. What do you think?
It's a possibility. I mean, the reason I think it's a possibility, obviously, is because I think there will be some surprises in Justice League. I mean, I think that every one of these movies, whether it's DC or Marvel, there's something like, oh, look, that person's in it, but it doesn't necessarily mean they're going to have a movie tomorrow. But if we were doing percentages, I'd say 35%.
Wouldn't that be a cool angle? This kid in the movie you periodically see, you don't know why, and then when it's all going down, he says Shazam turns into The Rock is the first thing you ever see for Shazam is in the movie while you're watching it. That'd be pretty cool. I think if they haven't locked down The Rock, because you're right, it was about 3 years ago, I think that's what's making Ben Affleck go, you know what, guys, lock it down or it's not happening ever.
Yeah, just finish the Batman script. That's all you got to worry about.
Okay, well, okay, Wendy, you've seen the picture they're talking about?
Yeah, so the picture is of Henry and The Rock at somebody's backyard with the sunset, and they're just having drinks, and the caption says, this is from Henry Cavill's Instagram, Merry Christmas and Happy New Year from Superman and Black Adam, The Rock. Today we drink like gentlemen and come together as friends. We are excited for what the future brings. #dangerous gentlemen, DC worlds will collide, and Superman.
Oh, jeez.
That sounds pretty convincing.
Well, you want to adjust your 35%?
45%.
I'll go as high as 50. Look, they got to get it. 3 years ago they announced him.
Right.
And we still have no idea.
You know what's funny about that is when I was like, Shazam, I'm like, oh, yeah, The Rock's playing Black Adam, who's a bad guy. Still would be a really cool angle seeing this guy while walking around, you don't know who he is, turns into Black Adam and
busts
down.
I still stand by this. I believe I'm going to go as high as a 25% chance. I think there's a 25% chance that The Rock is playing both Black Adam and Shazam. When you look at the source of their powers, if they want to massage the source material a little bit, that – you know, Black Adam, their source is the same power, and they are the same looking guy. 25% chance. 75% chance is not. 25% chance, I think that's what they're going to do.
Kids, we're throwing a lot of fractions at you in this episode. I hope you paid attention to Matt.
All right, what's next?
Timothy Platt writes, is the Roadhouse remake still on, or is it pretty much dead in the water now?
Good question.
Is the Roadhouse remake?
Ronda Rousey is
I think it's
bouncer.
Toast.
It's got to be dead.
Her movie career is toast. It is done. We were talking about this before we went on air. Her managers, or whoever managers were that gave her that fight, should be fired from everything. Because, like, why in God's name would you give her the champion right after her confidence was shattered? and especially for this movie career, you put her up against Mark Reilly, and you let her just crush him. And you put sorry, Reilly. You put her up against anybody.
Can Reilly bring his scarf into the cage?
Yes, and she can choke him out with it. Anyway, she should have fought a tomato can, beat that person, then continue with the career, then give her a title shot afterwards. There was no way she was winning that fight, and they killed her movie career, and they killed everything else with that fight. It was silly.
Well, look, let's call a spade a spade. She never should have had a movie career in the first place. She can't act.
Totally.
So I don't care how famous she is. She can't act. She shouldn't have a movie career anyway. Look, Ronda Rousey was, at the time, before that Holly Holm fight, was as dominant an athlete in their respective sport that we've ever seen. She was fighting the number one contenders in the world. In three fights in a row, she finished in under 45 seconds. Three fights in a row, she finished her opponents in under 45 seconds. That's insane. Absolutely insane. But that day has gone. That's in the past. She's not the same person, whatever. And that, if I didn't already think her career was done as far as acting goes, getting just her lights knocked out in under a minute, and that an embarrassing minute that could have lasted 15 seconds, she's not going to be seen as a universal badass anymore. It's done. This movie should not come out. I don't think we're going
to
see it.
I mean, I'm still curious as to whether they're going to do her biography, because that was the first movie that was going to come out, is her starring as herself, playing, you know, getting to see what her life was like. Because that's a very interesting story to tell. I don't even know if that is on the table right now. If that's something that she would want to do, if that's something that her, you know, her team or whatever believes there's still an audience for. So I think that's the movie you need to get off the ground first. But Roadhouse is one of those classic 80s movies we're talking about, where I don't think you can reboot Roadhouse. I think you add on to the war.
All right, let's take two more.
All right. Muhammad Hassan Ali writes, which J.J. Abrams reboot did you like the best? Mission Impossible, Star Trek, Star Wars, and which franchise should he do next? Bond?
Well, Star Wars wasn't a reboot.
Yeah, neither was Mission Impossible.
And neither was Mission Impossible, and neither was Star Trek.
I think they were talking about taking over. taking over. Re-existing
My favorite of those movies is The Force Awakens, but the most impressive job to me was the Star Trek one. Mm-hmm. Because I admit it, full-fledged, for years I said, this is a doomed project. Rebooting the Star Wars thing, whatever direction they're going, this is a doomed project because this is a dead franchise.
Star Trek.
Because this was a dead franchise. There's nowhere to go with this. This is a full... So what's my favorite movie out of those? It's The Force Awakens. But what do I think was the most impressive job? It's the job he did with Star Trek, because he accomplished what I thought was unaccomplishable. You know, and so kudos to him, tip of the hat to that.
Wrong, sir. The answer is Star Wars. And I think it's because there was so much more pressure on Star Wars. Rebooting Star Trek, you announce that, and Star Trek fans get very excited, and you're curious, because they're never stopped going to making Star Trek movies. It's a question of if there's going to be a great quality to it. And he certainly invigorated that franchise, although he did turn off some hardcore Star Trek fans with that film. But there, you are in the spotlight of spotlights. You are in the pressure cooker when you are the guy that is signed on to bring back the Star Wars universe to prominence. So I think that was the most pressurized job anybody could ever have, and I think he knocked it the furthest out of the park out of all these movies we're talking
Christian.
About.
I do think, though, that Star Trek and Star Wars were reboots. I do, because if you look at because Star Trek was, you know, the way that they rebooted the franchise with the time element in the beginning, with Chris Hemsworth putting it back in there. Star Wars was kind of a rebooting past what we had accepted from the tone of the prequels, and then kind of getting us back into what it was. So they were rebooting it back into the public consciousness, as where Mission Impossible 3 was a straight up sequel. I mean, that's just all it was. But I will say, all of those movies, every one of them, very impressive, and brought all three of those franchises back to prominence, because John Woo's Mission Impossible is garbage. It's not good. It is really bad. It almost turned me away, and I didn't want to see it.
But the slow motion doves.
Oh, exactly. Yeah, he's hanging on the rock, and they're playing Metallica.
Keep them coming, Fettles. For me, that is one that I thought was very impressive, because I think that led to both being able to make 4 and 5, which are the best of the franchise. But Star Wars, obviously, bringing it back and now allowing Rian Johnson to do what I think could be possibly the best Star Wars movies of all time. Yes, I'm saying that. And then you have Star Trek, though I agree with John. I was never a Star Trek fan. I never cared about Star Trek fan. Because of what he did with the franchise, I look forward to these movies now, even with him not directing. I happen to think Beyond was the best one. I really do. I think the first one. But then Beyond was a really good Star Trek movie.
Oh, I love Beyond.
It was a really good movie. And I think that J.J. Abrams should be pat on the back for that.
As a lifelong Star Trek fan, Trekkies never say die. It was never dead. It was just asleep for a very long time. The Star Trek one is, again, the most impressive, like you guys said, for the reason of it did turn off, I think, the most, I want to say, vexed of the Star Trek fans. Most old school Star Trek fans who watched the Abrams one were like, it's less Star Trek, but I liked it. You know what I mean? And so that's how I was when I heard that they were making this Star Trek movie, but they were making it for people who love movies. They're not necessarily making it for Star Trek fans. That got me really interested in the movie itself. I wanted to see how that went. And it is, like we were talking about before, it's a reboot / sequel / it's the best of all worlds. It was done really well. Walked out of that movie having one of the best times I had that year, which I believe was 2009.
Mm-hmm. You know, here's the funny thing, though. When you talk about Star Trek in that era, you had a long line of Star Trek films that were doing this with the box office.
Absolutely.
They're worse. It was dying. You literally, this isn't hyperbole, you literally had a fan base that was literally dying off. They were creating no new fans. There was no new fans. This was a stagnant, dying franchise. And yeah, they did vex a little bit some of the hardcore fans from the originals, but you almost had to accept that and say, you know what? We can't just appeal to this dying fan base. We need to bring in new fans as well. And what they did, I thought was just remarkable. All right, last question of the day.
All right, last one comes. Oh, God, I lost it.
Welcome to 2017, everybody.
I found it. Alex Reed writes, what do you think of Adam Driver saying there shouldn't be any trailers for episode 8?
Okay, you know, we've kind of debated this and talked about this a little bit. It's fun to say. Mm-hmm. It's fun to say. But it's lunacy at the same time. Look, you could not do any marketing for Star Wars Episode 8, and you're going to break $1.5 billion. You will. But they don't want to break $1.5 billion. They want to break $2 billion. And the thing is, without the marketing, you're not going to do that. So it's nice to say that. It's fun to say that. It's cool to speculate about what will happen, but it's lunacy. They will absolutely market the hell out of this movie a lot.
Yeah, especially since you thought people were confused after Rogue One. Now Episode 8, they're going to be like, so is this the sequel to Rogue One? I didn't get a trailer. I have no idea where this is going in the chronology of it all. We, again, talked about this earlier on in the show. I think that's an awesome idea that I will never see. I guess I could just do this, but then John would be like, you have to watch the trailer because we're going to talk about it, so I can't do that. It's a cool idea in fairy tale land, but that would be so cool.
I disagree. I hate that idea.
Oh, really?
I hate it. I think that it would be silly. I think you can do I think you can do trailers without giving away the whole story and without giving away what's happening. I think that you want people to get excited.
Force Awakens really didn't give anything away.
Towards the end, they did with the international trailers. They started giving a little bit more. Yeah. But I think that you can do it. You've got to get people excited about it in the theater. You've got to see whether it's us talking about our reactions and stuff like that. You forget where we are today with internet, like getting all those. Beauty and the Beast putting that trailer out gets more people excited about the movie. It's the most watched trailer. Why? Because people are excited about it. They're going to watch what they hope to see in the theater. And that's the same with Star Wars. What are we going to see? Are we going to see more Luke? Are we not going to see any Luke in this thing? It's that excitement. We don't have to see. I agree with you guys. I don't want to know a lot about it going into it. But I want to see some shots. I want to see who's in it. I want to see what the focus of the movie is going to be. So we need a trailer.
You say you hate that idea. I say I despise it tenfold, sir, because I love watching Star Wars trailers. I get almost as excited to see a new Star Wars trailer as I do the actual movie. They're little two-minute pieces of art. Forget the fact that it's selling you something else. Just watching that, whether it's on a computer or in a movie theater, it is so exciting to me because it is a little movie. It's a little tiny movie. They show you some shots. You get to second guess a little bit of things. And at the end, a green lightsaber turns on and you lose your mind. I love that stuff because there's no guarantee of the quality of any Star Wars movie coming out. But we know we're going to get excited with the trailer. We know it's going to be a positive experience watching that thing. I love the trailers.
Quick question, and I agree with you on the fun of trailers for sure, and I think they should do trailers, but seriously put yourself in this situation. Close your eyes if you have to. You're in a movie theater. It's next December. Mm-hmm. This new Star Wars movie's happening. You know
it's pretty cool. It's pretty intriguing.
Yeah.
Sure. But never gonna happen. If we were to find out the movie was actually opening tomorrow and we had no idea and we did, that's a cool thought. But here's the thing. There's a lot of us that are gonna go to see the movie regardless. Absolutely. But here's a great example. I'm gonna tell this little quick story. My dad, all right? My dad is not a movie fan. My dad is not a Star Wars fan. He's not whatever. But when I took my mom to go see Rogue One last week, I was able to talk my dad into going because he saw the trailers. He saw the commercials. He saw the trailers. He said, all right, all right, I'll give that a shot. It's those guys, like my dad, they're going to be the difference between making $1.4 billion or making $2 billion. Mm-hmm. Internationally, it's because of the marketing. But also, quick story about my dad. This is a great grumpy old man story. But it's been a while since my dad been to the movie theater, right? So my mom, Anne, my dad, Anne's mom, Ray, we're all there at this theater in Oakville, Ontario, Canada. And we all start shuffling around. My dad decides, I'm going to get some popcorn and a soda. This is my dad, right? So I'm off over here doing one thing, and he goes up to the concession stand, right? He's going to order popcorn and soda. So he's been there for a minute. I start to walk up, and just as I get there, I just see my dad going, $18? Popcorn and a soda. And he said, I don't like being robbed. And he turns around and walks away. And after that, the entire chant for the rest of the visit with Anne and her mom was everything was $18.
Oh, that's amazing. So Mr. Campea hates movies. Is that why he kicked you out to the barn to do mailbags? Did you have to sleep there too? We're not letting Talkie Boy in the house this holiday season.
I want to hear about that spider person.
$18. All right, guys, that'll do it for us for this first installment of Movie Talk of 2017. Thank you so much for being here, and we look forward for you being here with us for the entire rest of the year. I want to thank the guys sitting at the table with me. First of all, Kristian Harloff, where can people find you?
Well, you can find me on Twitter, both Kristian Harloff on Twitter and Instagram, and I have to give a big thank you to all the Collider fans. You guys made the Schmodown spectacular work. Thank you so much. Each one of them had over 200,000 views. Thank you, thank you, thank you. I love the response and everything, too. If you haven't watched it, please go back, or even if you have, throw a like on there. It helps. It does good things. More to come.
Mr. Jeremy Jahns.
You can find me at Jeremy Jahns on Instagram, YouTube, and Twitter, at Real Jeremy Jahns on Facebook. Let's make 2017 a positive one, folks.
Over here, the man I like to refer to as the Prophet, Mr. Mark Ellis.
The Prophet, $200 million for Beauty and the Beast, and you can have a lot of enjoyment on the Schmoes Know YouTube channel. Chris and I just released our best movies of 2016 and our worst list. Always a fun time, and I will be in Omaha at the Funny Bone this weekend, Thursday through Sunday, telling jokes. Come on through.
Miss Ashley Mova.
Twitter, Instagram, Snapchat, Ashley Mova. Happy Monday, guys.
And, of course, Wendy Lee.
On YouTube at the Movie Couples channel and on Twitter, Instagram, Snapchat, at Wendy Lee Zaney.
And you guys can follow me simply on Facebook and on Twitter at John Campea. Again, guys, 2016 was only made possible because of your support and what you guys do, your involvement with us, your conversations with us, leaving comments, leaving thoughts, tweeting us, Facebook messaging us. We have appreciated it so much, and we're looking forward to being engaged with you guys in 2017 as well. Thanks for being here, guys. My name is John Campea, and until next time, bye-bye.
Hey guys, if you like this video, click the thumbs up button. Also, make sure you subscribe to our YouTube channel. It'll help you stay up to date with everything we've got going on here at Collider.